from the southern tier, my neighbor. We have Senator David Blaski, who's from the Syracuse region. And we have Senator Patricia Ritchie, who is from the North Country. And I'm very pleased, and we'll be hearing from him in just a moment, but Jay Madison from Jefferson County, I've known him for many years, does a great job with agriculture, economic development, and so he has a presentation that we're looking forward to. And I thought we also maybe could go around the room. I first want to introduce the commission staff from the Senate, and that's Tricia Squires and Kim Rossman. This is Caitlin Hill from my office. But why don't we kind of go around? Do you want to pick up from there?
I'm from Assemblywoman Gunther's office. Salinas Jorge, and I'm her legislative aide.
Okay, and good. I'm from Senator Young's office. I'm Teresa Rossi. I'm her counsel.
I'm from the Assembly Commission staff, Christina Williams. And Assemblywoman Gunther will be here.
I know.
Momentarily.
We heard that. Well, first of all, there are two issues. One, are they still in session?
Yes.
Yes. And I also heard the elevators are just jam-packed.
Yes.
Yes.
And people will elbow you out of the way.
Yes. No, you have to body block your way up the hallway just to appear.
I'm Kate Berry from Senator Breslin's office.
I'm glad to have you represented today.
Thank you.
Jessica June from Senator Young's office.
Right.
Adriano Bajorno with Senator Bleski's office.
Very good.
And I'm Todd Kuzniers with Senator Ritchie's office, and I'm her director of the Ag Committee.
Okay, very good. So, here we are. And, you know, first of all, I just want to mention, we actually had a great deal of success last year in passing several of the commission bills initiatives. How many were chaptered, Kim, do you know?
Three or four chaptered.
Three or four chaptered, so I thought that was a pretty good success rate. And for people watching, if they don't know anything about the commission, it has a great history. It's bipartisan. It's between both houses, the Senate and the Assembly, and we'll work together on improving quality of life in rural New York, upstate New York. And so it's everything from agriculture, jobs and economic development, health care, transportation, things like timber theft that they've tackled in the past. I mean, there's so many wonderful initiatives. So I want to sincerely thank the staff, because I know that the staff of the commission works extremely hard, and we're very grateful for all that you do, because you're in the trenches making sure that this legislation gets drafted and we go through the review process. Does anybody from the Senate, my colleagues, want to say anything? Would you like to? Oh, come on, you're so shy. You know, Senator Richard.
Thank you, Senator Young.
Thank you, Senator Young. Thank you for your leadership. And I know that Senator Ritchie is doing a great job with the Agriculture Committee, and we're very excited about that. And Senator Bleski has always been a strong voice for upstate, and we appreciate that too. And Senator O'Mara, it's great to have him as a neighbor and also as a friend, because you're working on southern tier issues. What I thought we could do is start with an update on the telehealth and telemedicine roundtable that we recently had. I just want to thank everybody. I thought that was really an awesome event. Today, I addressed the Home Care Association, and I know Senator Bleski has been very concerned about this also, as all my colleagues, and that home care seemed to be especially hit hard last year with the Medicaid redesign team. Some of the changes that came through, they were cut by $500 million. And as we know, in rural New York, access to health care is a critical issue, and especially home care. And I think home care has been very effective and very positive because they've been able to keep people in their homes longer. And most frail elderly would rather be at home with the supports because it improves their quality of life, but also it's cost effective when you think about it, because institutional care through nursing homes is a lot more expensive. So I have been amazed and some of the technology that we now have available through telehealth and telemedicine. People say, you know, Senator Hannon explained it very well, because some people don't know the difference between telehealth and telemedicine, but there is a difference in that telemedicine is more like linking up hospitals, for example. You know, it's amazing that you can access any teaching hospital medical center in the country now through telemedicine. And as you know, in many cases, some of our more rural, smaller hospitals have a very difficult time finding specialists and having that level of expertise. So telemedicine will help us in that regard. Telehealth, on the other hand, also is healthcare services that can be brought into rural areas. And that has to do with, for example, monitoring someone's weight from a distance, their blood pressure, you can even count the number of pills that they take, whether they even open up their cupboard, because as you know, sometimes with seniors, it's a concern about whether they're getting good nutrition. So there are a lot of really exciting advances from a technical standpoint that can help people be more independent and improve their quality of life. So the telehealth, telemedicine, putting the pieces together, roundtable was really, really effective. And now we've come up with some policy ideas. And I don't know if anybody wants to chime in. I know Senator Valesky has a legislation that we'd like to consider possibly making a commission bill.
Yeah, that's great. I just want to thank you and Assemblywoman Gunther for hosting that roundtable. I think it's important, and I think the support of the commission from a legislative perspective will draw some attention and focus on the telehealth, telemedicine issue. You know, the health committees obviously in both houses have a very broad legislative agenda, so I think by using the focus of this commission, I think can help us be successful legislatively, which will in turn help our local rural communities. So,
okay. We have some, and this is still a work in progress, but what we were able to do through that forum was to identify some of the barriers that get in the way of us being able to take telemedicine and telehealth to another level. And so I know the Assembly's been working on some issues too, but we have some pieces of legislation for us to consider today, and this is just a beginning. You know, we had some conversations about whether we should do kind of this omnibus bill or whether we should break it into pieces, and I think that it may be easier to break it into pieces and pass them individually because we may not be able to get the entire package done this year, but at least let's get started. So one of the first barriers, and I don't know if the staff, you know, want to jump into, but has to do with credentialing. We heard that very strongly and clearly during the forum. There she is. Okay. Hello, you made it. Assemblywoman Gunther, why don't you come right up front?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure the other assembly members. I checked with them. They were waiting for the end of session, and nobody was 100% of the time they would get here. So.
Okay.
That's just want to give you a date.
Well, we just started. We're actually talking about some of the telehealth and telemedicine initiatives that we'd like to bring forward, and I'd like to welcome our Vice Chair of the Rural Resources Commission, and that's Assemblywoman Avery Gunther, and Bob is here, so it's good. This is Jay Madison, and he's going to be speaking in just a moment.
Great.
He runs the IDA and works on Ag Economic Development, Agriculture Economic Development in Jefferson County.
Oh, great.
So I've known him for a number of years, and he has a lot of good expertise and input that I think would be beneficial to the Commission. But I know you addressed the Home Care Association today.
I did.
And so I don't know if you want to give an update to people on what happened there.
I don't know a lot of, you know, my background, but I was a nurse, and I actually did some home care, and we just talked about continuity of care and that we all want cost-effective and efficient care. But in a rural area, it's very unique. You know, our clients often have had somebody that has taken care of them for 2-3 years, maybe longer, so they've developed a relationship. And I think it's important that the governor and the Senate and the Assembly work together to look at New York City. And I always, you know, and I remember when I first came to the Assembly, the BOCES superintendents, their salaries were capped because of one incident or some bad actors. And I think that when you look at where the overutilization took place versus who's doing cost-effective medicine, there is a difference. So I think that you have to recognize that and see if we can sit down at the table and make sure that we continue to support our home care agencies in upstate New York. We, you know, they have great relationships in my county with public health,
So those relationships are already there. And, you know, again, you spoke about telemedicine, and I remember we used to do meetings between different small hospitals with, you know, with through the internet. And this is just a great way to provide healthcare, and especially in a rural area where we don't have a child psychiatrist, where we only have one neurologist, and if he goes on vacation, then we have no neurologist. So, you know, there's a lot of very, very good things that we can do for the upstate region, but I think you have to be thoughtful, and you know, instead of drilling down, you have to drill kind of up from the people that are in the trenches and create policies and procedures by really understanding what's going on in that unique area.
Right. Before we go into the legislation in depth, maybe we should just do an overview too, because we had targeted biomass as a potential area, and we actually have a proposal on demonstration project that we'd like to look at in the state. But before we do that, is it okay with you, Vice Chairwoman, if we have Jay give a presentation?
Absolutely.
Okay. So are you ready? Would you?
Sure.
Okay,
I'm enjoying the conversation.
Yeah, it's good. It's good for upstate. So why don't you go ahead, introduce yourself, and talk about some of the opportunities that we have, I think, in the state, especially from an economic growth standpoint.
Okay, sounds great. I appreciate the time, and I appreciate all of your time. It's an opportunity that we were excited to have. And so I'm going to hand out the propaganda first, encourage you all to come to visit the Thousand Islands.
And spend lots of money while you're there.
Well, of course, visit our wineries and our cheese stores and all of the great things that we produce. It's okay to stand?
Yes, yes.
And I'll hand these out as well. If you take one, pass it down, please. This is just real quick. This is not what I'm here to talk about, but as I said, never miss the opportunity to share our propaganda about Jefferson County and the Thousand Islands region. To guide it yourself, it's a drive it yourself tour, but unlike the normal, you've got a map, you follow the map, you read something, great, sounds exciting. This actually has it uses new technology, cell phone-based technology, where each of the stops that we have on our tour now have the ability to have a recorded message. You dial the number on a sign in front of the building. There's a stop number. You enter that stop number, and a recording will play that tells you all about that particular stop. It might be a stop where you're invited in, such as a children's farm, Old McDonald's Farm, that we have near Sackett's Harbor. Or it might be just purely an educational opportunity to learn about a dairy farm with an anaerobic digester. But the neat part is that message can be changed by making a phone call into the system, and we change the message, and bang, you've got up-to-date information about whatever that particular visit is. So it's neat, it's new technology, the kids love it. Anytime you can play with mom and dad's cell phone, you're golden.
Jay, may I ask a question?
Sure.
You put this together through the IDA, or was it the Tourism Promotion Agency?
It was a partnership between my organization and the Thousand Islands Tourism Development Council. Gary DeYoung, the director, and I had looked for years for something unique to develop such a tour. And Gary called me up one day all excited and said, I went to a cemetery and found this. And they actually use it in a cemetery near Rochester. It has a lot of historic people buried there.
Oh, I know,
there.
The Mount Hope Cemetery.
Yes, Mount Hope.
How expensive was this to, you know, put this together?
Roughly less than $20,000.
Fabulous.
And that was funded, Gary was able to access some I Love New York grant funds. I don't know the specific source. Yeah. But he was able to access some grant funds to help us get that started. And we've been maintaining it ever since. So it's just a great way to bring people into the county and have them get off the beaten path. The only thing that we've been able to do, and I'm really off my topic here, but that's okay.
Love it.
The only thing we've done in the county is we've finally been able to develop our own farm winery industry. And we have an 87-mile-long wine trail, Thousand Islands Seaway Wine Trail, which is fantastic. And people, I think last year we were around 60 or 70,000 people that traveled the wine trail. The problem is people travel the wine trail. How do you get them off the trail? This gets them off the trail. Each of our wineries has lots of these available. We have it on the internet. And now as people are traveling that trail, they can have this in their hand also and say, oh, I want to go take a stop by that and visit that particular opportunity. Or they can even call ahead. Feel free. Any that you want, I will get you.
Well, this is a great idea because ag tourism is something that we've been focused on in the state. And so if you have some recommendations for the commission, I think that would be great about how we could try to replicate that. There might be some things that we can do. Because
sure.
I think this would, you know, even for the wineries themselves, I mean, this would be a great thing, but also to tie it into other tourism attractions. I can think of several around my district. It's really great.
I would strongly encourage, one of the things that could be done, that the commission could do, and actually this was a message I wanted to carry to the commission today. In the past, we used to receive a printed newsletter from the commission. I don't know if you still do that.
Oh yeah, we have to make sure you're on the mailing list.
Okay, and I, as I mentioned that to my board of directors, there were a number of people that said, there used to be a newsletter, and it really was a fantastic newsletter, and I haven't seen it. So helping us get the word out through agriculture, for agriculture, about things like this, would be a great resource to have available. I apologize for my back being to you.
Jack, if you have a list of people who we want to make sure is on the mailing list, could you get that to us?
Yes, I certainly will.
That'd be great.
Is your name or anything here that we can contact you? Or?
Be honest, I don't believe I am on this brochure. We have the website. Yes, I have cards with me. If you go to that website, you'll be able to link. That's from the program I was just at. And I'll pass these around if Senator, if you want to comment. Getting the word out about this would be very helpful because it is something different. It offers the opportunity to have the ability to change your tour for the season, for the event, whatever you would like. So it is a great program, and it has been pretty heavily used in our area. So any other questions?
Can I
just ask a quick question?
Sure.
Just that I'm Assemblywoman Gunther's chief of staff. I don't know if you've had this issue up in your region. You have wine, you know, makers. Do you have any hard spirit folks who are doing distilled spirits?
Not yet. I've heard that we have a person that's considering that, but they haven't done that yet.
Yes, we do, and of course we're now hitting some roadblocks where, of course, the things that are in the law have to do with wine, but not the distilled spirits, which, again, they have, you know, this distillery there, and you get to see it, and you take the tour, and see how it all works, and how they do the different things. So there's kind of a new industry that's happening where we're not...
So we should...
Yeah. And also microbreweries.
Right, right.
Really catching it. So.
And just if I could just add one thing in about our new distillery, the grains come from our local farmers, and they go through the process. They're making grappa, they're making
vodka,
they're making
bourbon.
Scotch and bourbon. And what they do is, at the end product, they have all that mash left over. And what they use, we also have a very large Red Deer farm that supplies venison to New York City, and they use all the leftovers for food.
Right.
And then, you know, there's so many things that you can do, and it's like the perfect, you know.
Yeah, it's creating those synergies that can help us grow our agricultural industry, and that's fantastic that you've got that.
Yeah, and I guess there's another area they're looking to do the same thing, and so I guess we should include it in our legislation.
We should look at that.
The one thing I did want to talk to you about today, besides all of these other fantastic opportunities, is the dairy industry, our dairy farms especially. I'm sure you've heard, you know, the surface. You know, we've got fantastic growth in our dairy manufacturing. Chobani, Fage, Alpina, Great Lakes Cheese in Jefferson County. You know, tremendous growth in dairy manufacturing, and everybody's focusing in on that and saying, oh, let's bring in more manufacturers. Let's grow that part of our dairy industry. How many people have talked about, well, how do we grow milk production? we can bring in all those plants, and that's fantastic. And I just left the Northeast Ag and Feed Alliance and delivered the same message. We can grow all of those plants all we want, but we are missing the golden opportunity where we can really hit every one of our rural communities. And that's by working with our dairy farms to help them grow. And I'm not just talking about expanding in cow numbers. I'm talking about how do we help them improve their milk quality beyond where it is now. And it's high quality, but it can be better. And how do we improve milk quantity per cow? I'm getting into some specifics here, so please forgive me for the details. But we have the opportunity to grow milk production per cow. We're focusing on it in Jefferson County.
But now there's a program in New York State that they will go to each farm through the ag, and they'll go and they talk about how to feed. There's a program that they'll come to your farm free of charge.
There's a variety of programs that are out there and available, but none of them focus on economic development. They're all on education, which is great. Those are important. But will New York State, our local municipalities and others, will spend money on helping all kinds of businesses grow? But how much have we looked at helping those farms do the projects that will grow their milk production per cow, improve the quality of milk, and help all of these manufacturers get the milk supply that they need? And so in Jefferson County, I'll just give you the example of what we're doing. We've created a cow comfort grant program where we're doing a very small pilot project basis right now in a small watershed in the southern part of the county. We've obtained enough funding to supply 14 farms with a grant of $2,000 each. It's on a 50-50 cost share basis. And what we're doing is challenging them to do the projects that will help them either improve milk quality or milk quantity. And we're just starting to get this kicked off. We've got 3 farms entered into the program already. And we're seeing projects like trying to improve their bedding systems, which will do both, improve milk quality and quantity.
So how do you improve their bedding systems? Like what, you don't use dry?
One farm's putting in water beds. So the cows will now be sleeping in water beds. The folks, it sounds kind of crazy, but what they do is they take the bedding system, whether it's straw, sand, or other organic matter, sawdust, they take that out and they put in a matting system that contains water. And it's not like the water bed you have at home. It's a smaller mat, very durable. But what it does as far as cow comfort and health is it improves their hocks, their joints and their legs, which bear tremendous pressure. You know, you've got a 2,000-pound animal, and you know that does a lot of stress on their joints. The more a cow hurts, the less milk she'll produce. The more a cow hurts, the less the quality of her milk. So as you can improve these things, as you can improve their health, their comfort, the better production you will get. And so that's what this farm is doing. I didn't mean to pick that topic, that particular example, but it is something that many people aren't familiar with. So helping farms take a look at those projects and then giving them that little bit of stimulus, if you will, to put those in place, to take that next step. You know, because they're still, even though they've had a good year this year, they still remember 2009, which was a disaster of huge proportions when it comes to milk pricing. Mm-hmm. And they're still very wary of taking any unnecessary risk or any risk that's a little bit beyond the norm. And so they, you know, from what I'm seeing in our area, if you offer something that says, here, we're going to help you a little bit to take away that risk, to encourage you to start this, we're getting that interest. So it's a small effort. We're doing a pilot project for it in the county, in the southern part of the county, and we're pretty excited that this is going to help us start to improve our production and that milk quality in the county. And it's something I encourage you to keep your eyes on as we go forward. The only thing I'd like to talk about when it comes to taking advantage of opportunity, I'm going to tie two issues in here. One is a very difficult issue, labor. And Senator Ritchie, you've been right there in the trenches with me talking about the labor issue. Our farms face a huge problem, and that's finding good, skilled help, people willing to milk cows. The whole dairy industry, whether you're the owner of Chobani Yogurt or you're the dairy farmer with 80 cows, the most critical position is the milker. Without that milker, none of that happens. And so the problem we have is our farms are not able to find people who want to milk cows. It's the most difficult position on the farm to fill right now. And so we've been working to try and help them resolve that issue. We're not having much success. And a lot of our farms do employ Hispanic workers. I'll use that term because I don't, that's the term I'm used to. Please forgive me if it's inappropriate, but Hispanic workers. And we estimate probably a majority of those Hispanic workers are here illegally in the United States. So now my farms are in a position where they are afraid to grow because they don't know if law enforcement will show up tomorrow and haul their workers away and then arrest them. And we had that happen in Jefferson County this year. So now I have farms that are saying to me, some of the best farms in my county are saying, Jay, I'm not going to add more cows because I'm not going to put myself any more at risk of getting in trouble with the law. And I'm not kidding you. They are not willing to expand their herds because they don't want to incur more risk. We're trying to resolve that through trying to build a local workforce, but it's next to impossible. And I know the labor issue is a national issue. The other side of that is I have smaller farms that are now looking at, okay, if I can't find people to work on my farm, is there another way? Can I use robotic milking equipment to milk my cows? I have one farm in particular right now in the northern part of the county, River Haven Farm. It's a beautiful farm right on the shore of the St. Lawrence River. And they would like to put in a robotic milker, and I'm trying to help them do that. But they're looking at a $500,000 project. A 100-cow dairy farm is looking at a $500,000 project to do that. Here's the challenge. They're not creating jobs when they put in that robotic milker. They're doing away with jobs. But that's what they're forced to do because they said, we're not going to hire the Hispanic worker and we can't hire locals, so how do we address this issue? When I look at the economic development programs here in New York, wisely, everything is geared towards job creation. That's a good thing. Except for when we look at the dairy industry especially, sometimes that immediate job creation isn't there, but the ripple effect of maintaining that farm and the jobs that it supports are very important. And if they can't find people to milk the cows, they're not going to be able to maintain that ripple effect throughout the community. So it's a growing need here in New York State. More and more farms will want to use robotic milkers. But if we don't have the ability to assist them, then we've got a problem that we're not solving. And it does need to get solved somehow. It's not cheap. It's not going to get cheap. And it's an issue that would be very beneficial, especially to our smaller dairy farms. So lots of opportunity. Couple examples of things that we're trying to do. I encourage you to look at how we grow milk quality and quantity on our farms, and then also how do we help farms solve that issue of the workforce in a way that they can afford to do it.
Do we have any questions for Jay?
just a comment. Jay has certainly done an outstanding job in Jefferson County, and I know that some of the surrounding counties would certainly benefit if they had somebody doing the same to help them in their area. You bring up a very sensitive issue and talk about farm labor and something that not a week goes by that somebody doesn't stop in my office to kind of comment on the situation that they're in. So it's a very sensitive situation, something that certainly needs to be looked at.
Jess, could you close the door, but make sure it's not locked, please, so that someone will listen.
Did you have a question?
Oh, yeah. I remember when you guys started the Come Farm with Us, which is your web
site,
right?
Yes.
And part of that, wasn't that to attract farmers from other places to move to Jefferson County?
When yes.
You had farms? Whatever happened, and is that still an issue?
It's still an opportunity, especially in other areas of New York State. We still do the Come Farm With Us program. That was an effort. It originally started as a four-county effort, and because of funding cutbacks to Cornell Cooperative Extension, they were the agencies in other counties that were working with me on this. They basically had to drop doing that for the most part. We still maintain our website, comefarmwithus.com. That's the county's ag website. We still maintain the regional website to attract people. Folks, there are people looking to come to New York State to buy agricultural land. There is tremendous opportunity for folks to come into New York State. The problem is nobody's marketing New York State as a place to come to farm. We still do it in the county, in Jefferson County. My issue is, previously, I didn't market the southern part of the county. That was where the core area of dairy farms, you've been there with me as well, that's where the core area of dairy farms is, and they point blank told me, don't you dare bring people into southern Jefferson County to compete with an already very hot land resource. So the northern part of the county, eastern part of the county was where we were doing our marketing efforts. But now my dairy farms are expanding, which is great. My dairy farms are expanding into the northern part of the county. I have wineries buying land to put in vineyards. I have folks from New York City wanting to buy farmland to put in beef operations. And we have biomass farms starting up. So we're seeing tremendous growth in agriculture in our county. So I'm not out there pushing the Come Farm With Us program as much. It's still a great opportunity for New York State, and something that I was talking with Pat Hooker and another gentleman at the conference I just spoke at. I never understood why other counties have not duplicated it or tried to, make their own version of it, because there's folks out there that would love to farm in New York State.
My goal is to get rid of all the goldenrod in upstate. Because you see so many acres of fallow farmland that isn't in production, and why aren't we doing more to try to encourage that to get more into production?
And you led the charge on this whole thing. And also that attracting new farms to the Jefferson, that was you?
Yeah. For Jefferson County, yes, I'm the lead person. But in the four county region, it was a partnership between my organization, the Ag Development Corporation, and Cornell Cooperative Extension Association.
But you work for the county.
I work for, it gets
kind
of
confusing. Yeah, because sometimes funding.
Yeah. I work for the Jefferson County Industrial Development Agency, and I'm assigned to the Jefferson County Ag Development. That's what they purely hired me for, was that purpose.
Mm-hmm. Are there other counties? How many other counties have a similar position like yours?
Nobody.
That's right, I thought that's the only one. Yeah.
I'm Sullivan County, which we have. But, I don't hear the same story from my dairy farmers at all that you're telling me that's happening in your county. Yeah. I hear completely the opposite.
I can't keep up with them.
Yeah.
Even when they're telling me I'm not going to grow my herd size because of the labor issue, I have a dairy farm that went from 5 years ago 70 pounds per cow, which is a pretty good size production per cow, up to 90 pounds per cow. Well, he's actually over 90 pounds per cow right now, and that's fantastic. So he's holding
increase the herd, but just the quality and the
quantity per cow. And that's great.
We have a place, it's called the Center for Discovery, and it's a, they own a lot of farmland, but it's health delivery and education for kids with disabilities, a lot of kids with autism. Mm-hmm. And so they have an organic kind of farm, not with the stamp, but truly, or, you know, it's organic sure. without the stamp. And they have, I think, 30 cows, Steve, and they've increased their production tremendously, but they've done it through nutrition sure. and what they feed them. Yes. But I love the waterbed story.
Yeah, it is a neat thing to see. And when I talk to the public, especially the press, and I tell them the cows are sleeping on waterbeds and they're getting pedicures, they sort of look at me with a strange look. They're getting pedicures and they sleep on a waterbed. What's wrong with this picture?
Yeah, and right now I feel like my dairy farmers are they're so despondent. And again, like you said, they owe so much money from, you know, 2 years ago, that they're still paying that off. Normally, you have a bad year, a good year, usually you can pay things, but they're having a really difficult time. And my banks in the area, by the way, normally they always had a line of credit. They're not so great about lines of credit anymore. So it's just making it difficult all around.
Yeah, really 2006 through 2009 were the years of the dairy crisis, and it was terrible.
And they got into a lot of debt.
Right, so.
But this is great.
Senator Ritchie is very fortunate because she represents an area that has been very innovative in agriculture. As far as like the precursor to the Farm Viability Institute, it really started in the North Country, and Jay's been leading the charge on that. So Jay, I'm going to ask you for a favor.
Okay.
If you have policy ideas that you feel that the commission could be helpful with, please let us know. For example, this is a great idea. And if you have other things that we can do to promote agriculture, agritourism, or just business and job development, we would love to hear those ideas, okay?
Sure. I'm more than happy to help out. And the senator was nice enough to have me serve on her ag advisory task force. So I'll work with the senator and feed the information to you. And I appreciate all those opportunities.
And she's doing a great job with the Agriculture Committee in the Senate too, so but there is a crossover with the Rural Resources Commission. So I just want to, on behalf of the Commission, to sincerely thank you. It's not easy to get from the North Country here to Albany.
Oh, you call me, I'll come down.
Okay.
I always appreciate
it. And there's no snow this year. Usually you guys get stranded up there.
Yeah, I actually drove through Redfield and Osceola to get down here yesterday, and normally in February that's the last place I'm going to drive to come down here because of the lake effect snow. But it was beautiful drive.
That's great. So thank you so much.
One last thing,
yes, yes.
As a person who has an 83-year-old mom living in my house, it's very important to have the ability to have folks that will come to your house to help take care when they're in a position where you. When they're ill or have had surgery and stuff. I've lived it. I know what it's like. And so having folks that can come into your house to check on your mother while you're at work is very helpful.
That's
so I thought I'd just throw that in there.
Thank you. We appreciate that.
If you don't mind, Senator, my son has a basketball game at 6. So.
Oh, my gosh.
You better make it.
Yeah. Be careful.
I will. I'll drive 65.
Okay. All right. We'll tell the truth.
Thank you very much, Senator. I really appreciate it. Good to see you again.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, folks.
Thank you so much.
Have a wonderful day.
Thanks.
I'll leave all these.
Yes,
Thank you.
Okay, so we have, just moving along, because the interview is really short on time, but you'll find in your binders the legislative session, sponsorship of bills. There's a sign for proposed legislation on some commission things that we'd like to put forward for your consideration and your input today. So I don't know if you've had a chance to read through some of that here, but the first is the marketing retail farm operations. And you know, love to have the assembly jump into it any time. It's right. Let's see, is that the second page?
Okay. 49.
You got it? Mm-hmm. Okay. So does the staff want to maybe give an outline of what the bill entails?
Sure. Yeah. Marketing retail farm operations includes retail farm operations such as roadside stands and on-farm markets and the definition of farm operation for the purposes of encouraging direct-to-consumer sales.
Does anybody have any question about what you're saying?
No.
Okay, is this something you're interested in?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. All right, so we'll try to advance that. Farm woodland assessments.
Increase the farm woodland acreage that is all.
I'm sorry, before you go ahead. Are all the members of the commission sponsors on these bills?
That's their.
Okay.
Currently.
That's what the sheet's for.
Right, so what we want to make sure is that you fill this out if you want to be a sponsor on it. Okay, so that we get everybody on the legislation.
It's due back by February 10th for that memo. That bill increases the farm woodland acreage that is eligible for an agricultural assessment from 50 to 100 acres.
Good job. Any questions? Real property tax exemption for physicians in charity areas.
This is a new bill that was brought to us by Iroquois Health Alliance. And it permits communities by local law resolution to offer a partial tax exemption for real property purchased by a physician who resides in and works in an area designated by the Commissioner of Health as experiencing a physician shortage.
You know, a lot of, I don't know in your area, but I know that we have physicians that have practices and new practices in our area, and they'll often go to the IGA and different places because it is a business. So I'm not sure, you know, I think that this is something I have to talk through.
Okay.
Do you know, because
yeah,
we
sure
do have, you know, so many, we have exemptions already, so.
Right.
And this is specific to residences, right?
Yes. Oh,
not
yeah.
For the, not for the practice.
For the residents?
It's just for the residents, yeah.
Well, why don't you take a look at it?
Yeah,
we can discuss it.
Yeah, I think that we can do that.
One of the things I do want to mention that we know that healthcare in general is a real issue in rural areas, and that's why we're doing telemedicine, telehealth.
Mm-hmm.
But also, one of the really problematic areas is in dentistry. And we're looking at, I talked to somebody last night, but we're looking at possibly bringing forward some. Initiatives, and again, we'll discuss it through the commission, but some ways to bring more dentists into rural areas, because as you know, it starts early. I have very young children who have all the teeth decayed out of their heads, and it's creating very significant health issues, and so we need to bring access to dentistry in more rural areas too. I don't know if that's something that you've seen.
You know, we do have dentists that you and I go to, but the problem in my area has been that they don't accept Medicaid. There's not many that accept Medicaid. Normally, a young dentist might, to build up a practice, might accept Medicaid, but after that, what we've done really is we've done alternatives to that. We have a program that's called Prasad, and they go and they do that hygiene in the schools. They get a captive audience, because sometimes you have to get that kid to a dentist. But again, our problem really hasn't been the fact that there's not a few, I mean, we can count how many dentists, but they don't take Medicaid.
Right.
And as far as I think sometimes with a rural area and giving a physician an incentive for their residents, you know, when a physician comes to my area, sometimes we can get physicians to Sullivan County, but they don't live in my county. What they do is their biggest concern, especially new docs, are they're gonna have a family, they're looking at their schools, and they're looking at healthcare in general. So those are some of the things. It's like it's like a domino effect. So I don't know that an exemption, and I think about my seniors and then my middle class folks that have been here for a while, and I think that, you know, a doctor's in a better situation than a heck of a lot of people in my county. But as far as I'm not sure what we can do about the dentist. It's more about the Medicaid. And I think that even though, like, we have people saying about Medicaid, but if the reimbursement was better for pediatric dental care, then I think that more dentists, because they did it with pediatricians with Medicaid. Now, Medicaid pays more to pediatricians than our paid insurance company. And so now, pediatricians are, you know, they're fine to take kids with Medicaid. So maybe it's the reimbursement for pediatric medicine in rural areas.
That's worth further discussion, for sure. Farmland restoration tax credit.
We're also referring to it as a biomass personal income tax credit. Creates a refundable 25% personal income and business franchise tax credit, up to a maximum of $50,000 for expenses of soil improvement and or farmland improvement projects on farmland to be used in the production of perennial crops.
you know, when we had that meeting, when was it? Everybody at this table was there. It was September. That was one of the areas that cropped up, no pun intended, by biomass people, was that they were concerned about this issue. So this would actually address that. Any discussion, Senator O'Meara or Pulaski?
Good.
Telehealth credentialing?
Right, there were three additional measures that were not included in the bill book initially, but have been added along with the revised sign-up form. The Telehealth Credentialing Act would permit patients in site hospitals to rely on information from a distant site hospital in granting or reviewing the credentials of a healthcare provider based in such hospital who is providing telehealth services to the patient's site.
Any questions or concerns?
Have you called hospitals and see how they feel about this? This is the beginning, but I mean, have you spoken to
the background? The background for this is from the Health Care Association. They're very out front in promoting this with the commission.
We do that with radiology anyway, don't we? Because we have somebody reading an X-ray or a CAT scan. Yeah. In Manhattan, and we're getting results for a patient that's in Sullivan County. So I think there's precedent set on this.
Mm-hmm. Telehealth Reimbursement Parity Act
requires insurers and Medicaid to provide coverage for the provision of telehealth services.
Questions, concerns? And finally, the New York Telehealth Telemedicine Development Program,
which is Senator Pulaski's bill.
Did you want to speak about it, Senator Pulaski?
You can go ahead if you want to touch on something.
Just the highlight I have is next, the New York State Telehealth Telemedicine Development Act to coordinate and focus state policy and program planning for telehealth and telemedicine.
Yeah, I think we're trying to directing the department to focus on the issue and develop a coordinated policy and report to the governor and legislature as further actions that we had before.
So it's a good bill. You also see that there's 2012 current legislation, stumpage value of trees, waterfront revitalization referendum. These are not new pieces of legislation, but they've been commission bills in the past. So we'd like to try to advance as many of those as we can. And is there anything that I'm missing?
That's it.
Well, I think we have a full agenda, and I want to sincerely thank everybody who wanted to get done before 3, and so we're going to meet that deadline. Someone out there, do you have anything that you want to bring up?
No, I just wanted to thank you for Jay coming. I thought that was great information. Yeah. I think it would help all of our areas, and he's just a great gentleman. I'm sure I'll be talking to him soon.
Mm, good.
Sounds great. So
I think we have a great commission staff and also great commission members, and I want to thank everybody because trying to create some synergy, some innovative ideas, and you've been very key to that. So I just want to thank you for that
partnership. Thanks to all the staff.
Yes, thank you.
They were part.
Yes, they do. I know they do. Thanks, everyone.